Today's This Week in Startups is brought to you by HostGator, your one-stop shop to getting your business online. Your domain name, website hosting, website design, even your marketing, they've got you covered. Have questions? Their team is there 24/7 via chat, phone, and email to help you. Start today with 30% off with coupon code TWIST. And LegalZoom. Whatever your legal question, start with LegalZoom. Form an LLC, register your trademark, and protect your products. LegalZoom is not a law firm, but you can get personal advice from their network of independent attorneys in most states. Enter promo code TWIST in the referral box at checkout for $10 off.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to This Week in Startups. Today on the program, AJ Daulerio, who is the founder of Ratter.com, which is taking on the local news space in blog format. He is a brilliant, brilliant editor. You know him because he was the editor-in-chief of Gawker and Deadspin, and he's in the news right now because of the Hulk Hogan sex tape lawsuit. It's a $100 million lawsuit that people are talking about. It has a 10% chance of taking out all of Gawker. Actually, Nick Denton actually produced that statistic. And he's going to trial in July. And it's an amazing episode where we talk about all of the issues around the Hulk Hogan trial, all of the issues around new media, paying for stories, investigative journalism, and the rise of blogs, the rise of Gawker, all of this great stuff that he's been involved in. And it's a really insightful episode for those of you who are starting a media company or are fans of media and where it's all going. Stick with us.
It's what it's all about, man. They said money is the root of all evil. Funny how it feeds my people. We ain't gonna live like equals until we get the money, spend the money and defeat you. Money is the root of all evil. Funny how it feeds my people. Yeah. We ain't gonna live like equals until we get the money, spend the money and defeat you.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to This Week in Startups, the show where we talk about startup companies, technology, and essentially building things and trying to make them work in the universe. It's hard. Most startups fail. But we forge ahead knowing that when 1 out of 10 or 2 out of 10 succeed, boy, do they change the world sometimes. And boy, is that a great thing. And an effort that's worth doing. Content, of course, is the hardest space of all, which is why I chose it as my career path. Being a content entrepreneur sucks. I can tell you that. It's hard. There's a lot of noise. It's fiercely competitive. And things are changing so quickly. Blogs, mobile, native advertising. And that's why we love talking about media. We love talking about magazines, zines before that. Blogs and everything. And so I never invest in content businesses, but I invested it in Ratter, which is AJ Daulerio. Am I pronouncing it correct?
Daulerio? Yes, it is. Daulerio.
Daulerio. AJ Daulerio, of course, was the former editor-in-chief of Deadspin and Gawker. You came to Deadspin after Will Leach.
Yes.
Who worked for me, by the way.
I know.
Very small known fact. Will Leach, when he was doing a column, Life of a Loser?
Yeah, yeah.
Smart, great writer.
He was, yeah. Will and I met at the time when he was working for you because we were doing a site called The Black Table together.
Oh, you were doing The Black Table with him. I love The Black Table. That was really
Yeah, fun. That's where we met. And, you know, that's kind of where our friendship started.
So he would come back, you'd get home in Brooklyn, you'd hang out.
Whatever,
and then he would just say, like, my God, my boss, Calacanis, is such an a-hole.
Sometimes. I remember that, because, I mean, that was during your, one of your more notorious phases.
Silicon Valley Reporter?
Yeah.
Days?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was out there.
Right. And I remember, you know, Rafat.
Rafat worked for me?
Yeah.
Worked for me?
Yeah. I mean, you had a personality at that point. You were one of those guys. You and Nick, I think, were both starting. Because I came to New York in 2000, so this is around 2003-ish when I guess the first generation of blog entrepreneurs started, and you and Nick kind of had that battle with
we were fighting it out over talent and blogs and supremacy of the space.
Right, because you had Engadget, right?
We had Engadget, yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, the story was very famous. I tried to hire Elizabeth Spires.
Yes.
Not Spears, Spires.
I believe it's Spires.
It is Spires, yeah. And I was like, how much is he paying you? And I found out she was getting paid $1,500 or $2,000 a month by Denton. And I was like, I'll match it and I'll give you a MacBook.
Right.
And you can keep the MacBook if you work for me for 2 years. And I'll give you equity in the blog. We partners in the blog.
Right.
And she wouldn't take the deal. She said, I was going to go to New York Magazine.
Yeah.
And then Shenny Jardin was like, you know, you should really check out Peter Rojas. He is pretty smart from Boing Boing. And she used to work for me at Silicon Reporter. And I met Peter and I was like, hey, Peter, how do you like working for Denton? He's like, I hate it. I was like, great, I have an offer for you. He took it. He became a millionaire.
Right.
He had massive equity in Weblogs Inc.
Yeah. And I think that really stoked Nick's competitive fire, actually, once he lost that battle from the UA. He became a lot more ruthless after that. So,
well, the ruthlessness that started, actually, he had poked the tiger, because what he did was he wrote, when I came into blogs, that I was like the P.T. Barnum of like blogging, and that I was never going to be successful and all this kind of stuff. And so then I was sitting with my partner, Brian Alvey, and I was like, okay, how do I induce maximum pain on this individual?
Right.
He's like, well, we could just focus on our business and make it really great. I was like, yeah, okay, Brian, no. We have to kick him in the nuts as hard as possible. We have to make sure he understands that if he punches us, we're going to just jump him in an alley and beat him mercifully. What would be the thing we could do that would really make him pay attention? And I don't know if it was Brian's idea, but we were just like, if we took Elizabeth, who at the time was the number one blogger in the world.
Absolutely.
I was like, if we could get Elizabeth to break ranks, that would be so newsworthy, it would crush him. And I made a full run at her. I was like, you're incredible, you're number one. It's very rare in the world you're gonna be number one at anything. There's gonna be 1,000 more bloggers. There's no way to stay number one unless you have equity in a company.
Right.
Didn't work. She wanted to go back into traditional media.
Yeah, yeah. And it was strange because, I mean, at that time, I think that's what her leaving for New York Magazine, I think every person that started joining Gawker Media almost used it as a stepping stone to traditional media. And that was the goal. It was the goal, yeah.
But now we see something different, don't we?
Yep.
What do we see today in the market?
Well, I mean, Gawker itself has become one of those legacy publications in a lot of ways that I think most people want to work for it. I mean, it's a more traditional media publication.
It's a destination.
Absolutely. And you can stay there and you can, you know, make a very good living and you can have a lot of notoriety and a lot of, you know, acclaim. And it's a place that most people, I think, really should aspire to work for at some point, just because of the autonomy it gives you and the exposure. And you work with a lot of smart people that you're not going to find anyplace else.
When you found yourself there, take me back to that time, early time when you got to Deadspin. What is this, 2006, 2005?
Originally, and this was actually brought up when I told you we were watching the show with Lockhart Steele, that I was hired at Oddjack in 2005.
Oddjack.
Which was the gambling blog that failed.
Yes.
Yes.
This was awesome because I was obviously a poker player at the time.
I was not.
I loved Oddjack. Was that your idea?
No, it wasn't. It was one of those things that it was probably one of the first, ad-generated sites where Bodog threw a bunch of money. Remember when Bodog was throwing a bunch of money at everybody? So they...
Basically they funded it for $20,000 a month or something.
100, I think it was $100,000 for like the whole 6 months or something along those lines. And
it was a sponsored blog in a way.
Pretty much. And, you know, Lockhart had originally reached out to Will Leach to do it. Will hates gambling and, you know, is like very, very, very much against it because he's such a sports guy. And he said, you know, I'd really like to start a sports blog instead.
I know. I tried to get him to come to Weblogs, Inc.
I remember that as well. And so, you know, Lockhart went, like Will recommended me. I, you know, passed all the, which was basically just like humor blogging test at that point. Mm-hmm. And we figured we could catch up to the gambling later.
Humor blogging test.
Uh-huh.
What is that? Wait, explain that.
Well, I mean, you remember...
And we're talking, by the way, about Lockhart Steele, who went on to do... He was the editor-in-chief GM of Gawker.
He was editorial director of Gawker at the time, I believe, or managing
editor. Brilliant, brilliant editorial mind.
Yeah, and I mean, if you remember, and like most people, I think, who have whatever era of Gawker is their favorite, usually kind of goes around the Spires, Corey Seeker era. Mm-hmm. And there was a style which was... You know, funny headline, lead, block quote, exclamation point, joke. I mean, it was a very, very kind of house style that was...
Okay, so you have a funny lead, funny headline, mm-hmm. which will pull you in.
Yes.
Then you had a funny lead.
You have an establishing lead basically built off the headline. So your headline is basically serving as your lead.
Got it.
And then...
So get right into the story.
Yes. And then block quote... Something where you can spin off of and riff, and then big kicker, exclamation point.
Right.
And you used to see about, 80% of all blog posts around that era seemed to kind of mimic that voice. And that was both, Elizabeth, I believe, started it, and then Corey kind of, perfected it. And
it really gave you a dopamine rush because you wanted people to click to the jump and go to the permalink page to get that extra page view.
Yeah.
So you would get the block quote and then the rest would be after the jump.
Yeah. And it was, remember just like this was also, there was not a lot of writing put into this thing. It was probably, you're working with, 200 words maybe per blog post. But they're also doing around 12 per day. So there was an art to the way they did it. I think
a cadence.
Yeah, that absolutely I think made people better at this and almost like better writers in the long run.
Yeah.
Just because you got to see the economy of words in a very very just pure form at that point.
Yeah.
So when I did a test for Odd-Jack, I kind of adopted that tone. I mean, you set up like a Blogspot blog and you did that, and I would riff on the World Series of Poker or something along those lines.
Right.
And, I basically mimicked Corey and Elizabeth Spires as probably better than most people that also tried out for it. And that was probably why I got the job. And then, Lockhart fired me about 4 months later over Instant Messenger, AOL.
Which is how it was done, by the way, in that period of time, because nobody had any training in management.
No.
I mean, it wasn't like Nick Denton was some incredible manager, nor is he now. He's kind of a dysfunctional manager. Like he doesn't talk to people, right?
Yeah, he does. There's a different Nick Denton that existed, that exists now than back then. But, for Lockhart and I, when he fired me, and there was a lot of, ego involved in this and everything like that, and so I was very pissed at Lockhart, but we became really close after that.
Really?
And just by virtue of, kind of our social scene, but also once I went back to Deadspin, which is around 3 years later, we both found out that we kind of spoke this language of management and editorial strategy that most people didn't think about.
All right. Blogging. When we get back from this commercial break, I want to know why he fired you. Mm-hmm. What you learned during that period of time, and then what led you to start Ratter.
Absolutely.
Okay, when we get back. Oh, and also the Hulk Hogan thing. I'll tease that, too.
Sure.
When we get back on This Week in Startups. Hey, everybody. Let me take a moment to tell you about HostGator. Stop thinking about the business you want to do and just start doing it. Yes, it is the first step for web hosting and domain names. Go to HostGator.com, and it's a one-stop shop for everything you need. WordPress installs, drag-and-drop builders, easily set up custom email addresses, and do in-house design, SEO, and pay-per-click services. And it all starts at like $4 a month hosted. It's incredible with VPS and dedicated service, 24/7 support, 365 days a year. And we use it here at This Week in Startups because it's super, super affordable, especially compared to some other hosting options, which have gotten very expensive for us. And we were able to use HostGator to save literally thousands and thousands of dollars a month of my money. This is kind of important. And HostGator is saving me, Jason Calacanis, thousands of dollars a month, which I appreciate. The first 100 This Week in Startups listeners can sign up using the promo code TWIST25, and they will get a 1 year HostGator hatchling package for just $25. Yes, that's the 1 year of HostGator hatchling package for just $25 if you use TWIST25, and that includes unlimited disk space, bandwidth, unlimited MySQL databases, unlimited email accounts. I mean, everything's unlimited at this place, and it's super affordable. And don't worry if you're not one of the first 100, you can still save 30% using the promo code TWIST. So you have two promo codes there. Try the TWIST25, and if not, use TWIST, and you're going to get a great deal. Welcome to the This Week in Startups family, HostGator. We really appreciate the support you've been giving us and the technical team, Jacob and Jackie, as we continue to scale our business, and our expenses got very expensive, and we decided we would shop it around and see if we could find a good deal, and HostGator was an amazing deal. Again, we're saving thousands a month, and you can start for as little as, a couple dollars a month. It's a really great service. Go ahead and check out HostGator.com and thank them on Twitter. Welcome to the family, HostGator. Everybody, welcome back to This Week in Startups. My guest today, AJ Daulerio, who is the founder of Ratter.com. You can go check out Ratter.com. I am an angel investor in Ratter, and he's the former editor-in-chief of Deadspin, the awesome sports blog that's part of the Gawker Network. And you were the editor-in-chief of Gawker, too?
Or yes.
You had a stint as the editor-in-chief of Gawker. And we're talking about your first firing. Mm-hmm. What were you, 25, 30 years old?
I was around, let's see, I think it was 30.
30.
I,
was, okay.
I just turned. No, it was probably 29. About that. But yeah, it was. You know, Lockhart fired me over Instant Messenger, and it
but
was,
what was it over?
Traffic, more than anything.
You weren't getting the traffic.
No, not at all. It was one of those like moments when you kind of realize, you know, how demoralizing it is to almost like beg for traffic, especially within a Gawker network, which, you know, I the only way iJack was working is
if it hit
Jezebel,
the Gawker homepage.
Gawker, yeah, if, or like, you know, I College Humor linked to me or FARC. But you
so
know,
begging for links became the name of the game.
Absolutely. And you know, I couldn't do that. I couldn't sustain it. It didn't feel natural. And, you know, most of the things that were working for me had nothing to do with gambling. I would absolutely just, like, you know, go off the grid to try to make something work.
You jumped the fence.
That would absolutely just at least register with a larger audience outside of the game. Like, I didn't care about the gambling audience anymore. I just wanted to survive. But I didn't. And it was a great learning experience. And it really, doing Radar, I'm reminded a lot of my iJack experience. I would say that.
So let's talk a little bit about Radar. You have this idea for a blog, which is going to do the most difficult vertical in all of content, I believe, local.
Right.
Patch.com failed brutally.
Yeah.
Local newspapers are shuttering. And so you decide
right.
that you're going to use all your collective experience. And by the way, you kind of paint yourself as not being great at getting traffic, but you became a savant at getting traffic.
Yeah.
What was the story that you did that got the most traffic of any story ever?
Well, it's kind of interesting. I mean, there are two ways to look at traffic. And there's viral traffic, and then there's like the traffic which I like to attain, which is not people that read the site, but if it's a story that people talk about and they have no idea where it came from, that's actually the best traffic you can get. So
the word of mouth traffic.
Absolutely. And
why is that the best?
Because I think that reaches an audience that's ultimately the perfect audience you want to reach, which is one that doesn't necessarily have anything to do with your site. It's not has nothing to do with social. It has nothing to do with really the, you know, ability of the writer. It has everything to do with like the news gathering and basically the information you're putting out there being completely 100% yours. And
original content as opposed to just lifting other people's content.
Yes, yeah. And you know, I think it has to have something that also infiltrates basically just this very overcrowded marketplace of mainstream, you know, media overload that we have right now.
Got it.
Where you have to get other places interested in talking about your story, which is you're almost kind of making news. More than anything. And, you know, that's something that was kind of developed at Deadspin almost naturally when we would do things that most people would frown upon and just, you know, call unethical or, you know, things that were sleazy. But we were doing them with the intent of basically just like, you know, well, we know this information. Well, why can't we put it out there? And that was the best part of working for Nick and anybody at Gawker Media.
Denton is fearless as a publisher.
Yeah, and
he wants the truth to come out.
And I think that's ultimately something that sticks. You can't force that in people to actually, if they have that little gene or not. I just happen to have it, and basically it came to me naturally. And
you believe the truth should be out there.
Yeah, and
well,
I believe.
Why do you think? Where did that come from in your life, in your DNA? Is it in your upbringing? Is there something about you that makes you want the truth to be out there?
For me, and I've actually thought about that probably a little more than I think I would like to admit. But when I was working at local newspapers, like coming out of college, and you know, I was not the most, you know, I mean, artful writer, was not the best reporter, but what I used to do was basically just like have these relationships with local city council people. And you know, we would go out for beers and they would tell me all the stuff that I couldn't write. And
got it. The beer highway.
And I would absolutely just lean on them until I could finally get something that we could write about. And I remember at one point there was in a small city council meeting, and like there was something that was going on where the townspeople were furious about what wasn't being revealed, and had something along the lines of just like a council person taking funds along those lines. And one of the guys stood up and, you know, said, well, the only person who actually knows what's going on is, you know, AJ. So it points right to me. And, you know, I hadn't written about the story at that point, but like, it was that level of, you know, truth that I figured just like, you know, this is actually, if you lean on people long enough, this can actually come out. The better story is actually there, and the one that people actually want to read.
Yeah.
So I think that just carried over into things, you know, doing with Deadspin, and basically just like, you know, having good sources, having some information, being allowed to pay for some information.
Oh yeah, you guys were allowed to pay for information.
Yeah. And
okay, so let's get back to my original question, which is, what are the most memorable, you know, big stories of your tenure at the Gawker Empire?
I would say, you know, the
take me through the greatest hits.
Deadspin was the first real big one we had was Josh Hamilton, Texas Rangers, you know, back with the Texas Rangers. When he fell off the wagon, we had photos of him over January, basically just, you know, getting drunk and carousing with women. And this was during the height of his popularity as, you know, a reclamation project. And he had, you know, found God and beat heroin and had just won the home run derby and was basically the darling of everyone in media. And it was...
And what, someone just emails the tip line and it's like, hey,
we'd actually heard a couple rumors about it that had come in through tips, and then started to actually inquire within it, like as we usually do. We used to inquire with like the local newspaper reporters if there's anything there. Because I mean, a lot of the times you understand that their job, they can't really talk about these things or they won't get access.
That's a very interesting hack. So you could say to the local person in whatever location, to the local beat reporter, like, hey, did you hear about this?
Yeah. And sometimes they would, you know, say yes, but we can't talk about it. Mm-hmm. They would give us like some level of information just because, I mean, if they actually thought there was a legit story there that they weren't able to do, I mean, most of the time reporters would be at least accommodating in that type of information. But for this, it was really interesting because, you know, none of the local reporters actually just had any access to Hamilton besides basically his sponsor or anything along those lines. And they're like, well, we haven't heard anything about him falling off the wagon. So
you put it out there. What happens?
Well,
lawsuits? What?
No.
Denials?
No. Well, it's a lot of denials. And we started fishing around and basically just like, you know, I remember this one reporter from the Austin American Statesman, I believe. And I had emailed him basically just like, you know, doing a real cautious, like, you know, saying, hey, AJ Daulerio from Deadspin, I have a question for you. I hope we can talk off the record. And guy emails me back and he's like, I've got nothing about Tony Romo and Jessica Simpson. Sorry, AJ. And I'm like, well, I'm not actually talking about that. Oh, he's like, oh, you talking about something else? And I was like, yeah, well, I want to talk about Josh Hamilton. Have you heard anything about him falling off the wagon? Real dismissive with me and just like, you know, go ahead, and, you know, there's nothing about that. We would hear about it. You know, we're in the clubhouse all the time. And then he's like, you know, that. And we break the story a couple weeks later, have all the photos. The same reporter emails me back and he's like, hey, AJ, you know, I was, you know, this so-and-so from Austin American Statesman. I was wondering if we could, you know, talk about the Hamilton thing. And I just emailed him back and said, sorry, I don't know anything about Tony Romo and Jessica Simpson.
Crazy.
But that was one of the bigger, you know, things on Deadspin, which we dropped on like a Saturday afternoon, like which was supposed to be Dead Zone, and we were getting a lot of crap from like internally for not, you know, publishing this properly on like a Monday at 2 p.m. etc.
Right.
Well, we got it now, and you know, it's going to take off. Yeah. And it did at that time. You know, Gawker was actually still using page views as a metric, and this I believe we had a slideshow for it, but. We hadn't switched over to uniques yet, but I mean, we had all this unique traffic, and that was the thing about Deadspin was that, you know, while all the other Gawker blogs at that time were doing like 40, 50 posts per day, we were doing like 8 between.
Less is more.
Because we were just getting the ones that would actually work
and
do something original. And like, you know, it seemed like we were doing a lot of the tawdry stuff, but we actually weren't. I mean, and a lot of that was just due to, you know, myself and Tommy Craggs, who I had hired like around 2009, that we just couldn't function as bloggers very well. We were very good at generating ideas and getting some really big stories, but, you know, on a day-to-day grind, we were terrible.
All right, when we get back from this break, we'll talk about Radar.com, which you can all check out right now, with AJ, and we have to talk about this crazy Hulk Hogan case when we get back
we do.
On This Week in Startups. Hey, everybody, let me take a moment to thank LegalZoom for sponsoring This Week in Startups. Whenever you have a legal question, you should start with LegalZoom. You can launch your dream and protect your ideas with LegalZoom. You can incorporate or form an LLC, register your trademark, protect your products and services, apply for a patent. Wow, you can do that? That's pretty cool. Trademark, copyright, or provisional patent applications are all done by LegalZoom, and over 1 million business owners have started with LegalZoom. It's not a law firm. So they've built a network of independent attorneys in most states to provide legal advice and other useful services to help you run your business. It's completely transparent. It's got upfront pricing, no hidden fees. And of course, Jill the Comet Bork from Rush Ticks, one of the companies I've invested in, she's used it over and over again for routine filings like trademarks and incorporations, saving thousands of dollars. It's inexpensive and the flat rate is easier on her budget. That's what she told me. And it's fast. She can log in and see the status of her documents, and she has a dedicated contact always available. It's a smart choice for startups, according to Jill. And if you want to try it, you can enter the promo code TWIST and get $10 off. That's right. Use the promo code TWIST for $10 off at LegalZoom.com. Promo code TWIST in the referral box at checkout. Thanks again to LegalZoom for supporting independent media like This Week in Startups. Hey, everybody. Welcome back to This Week in Startups. I'm your host, Jason Calacanis. You can find me on the Twitter at Jason. You can find the show at TWI Startups on Instagram and on Twitter. Our website is thisweekinstartups.com. And yeah, you can find us everywhere. This Week in Startups in iTunes. You can find us on TuneIn. You can find us on all those other podcast players. So my guest today, AJ Daulerio. Of course, he was the editor-in-chief of Deadspin and Gawker. And now Radar.com. Okay, let's finish up this the Gawker tenure. The Hulk Hogan, you were editor-in-chief of Gawk when the Hulk Hogan thing broke at Gawker, right?
Yeah, I mean, I was...
All right.
I authored the post, I edited it, I shepherded it, I had the source who had...
Okay,
the...
now Bubba the Lunch Sponge, Bubba the Love Sponge...
There you go.
Videotaped Hulk Hogan having sex with his wife.
Yes.
Which is weird.
Yes, it is. Were not to them, but I mean...
Okay, were they like swingers or something? Or he suspected and he put a camera in there? Did that ever come out why he did it?
He was actually in the tape saying, just, you know, you guys have fun. I mean, it was apparently just an agreement between, you know, Hogan and Bubba and Heather that... So they lived
some sort of open lifestyle or whatever the kids are doing these days, open relationship, whatever they call it, polyamorous.
Right.
You guys get an email... saying, here's a tape? How did this come about? I know there's a legal case going on right now.
Yeah.
In Florida. $100 million lawsuit.
Yes.
Nick Denton says 5% chance it takes out Gawker, a 10% chance it takes out Gawker. I assume he's being dramatic. Or is it seriously you have the potential to take out Gawker, as we know it?
The part of this is just, you know, because it is a jury trial,
yeah,
and whatever the award is, I mean, in Florida, you have to post a bond immediately what the award is. So for 2 years and plus 2% interest.
Okay.
So, you know, if it's a significant award, I mean, obviously.
It's a $50 million award.
It's, you know, I mean.
It can't possibly be that much anyway, but $10 million award.
Here's the thing. It just, you know, this suit has been going on for 3 years. At every stretch of the way, it's been the worst case scenario. Like in terms of just like, is it going to get this far? It's almost like this black cloud that's, you know, I mean, I haven't worked with the company in 2.5 years, but I'm a primary defendant in this case. And every single time that I go through another round of discovery or something along those lines, it'll come up and say, I'm just like, you know, is this over yet? But it's not. Now it's, you know, for 2 weeks in July, I mean, I have blocked out because I'm going to be in Pinellas County, Florida as a lead defendant in this case.
You have to, let me ask you a technical question.
Yeah.
If you are defended in the case, mm-hmm, you have to pay for yourself to fly down.
No, I'm indemnified through Gawker, and they're
picking up the tab for you to come down there.
But it is.
Are you at risk personally in any way, or no?
Well, I'm being. It's strange. I can't say. I mean, there are punitive damages, basically, just, you know, Hulk suing me and Nick individually as well.
Wow, that's kind of heavy.
It's one of these things that it gets stressful, but because it only happens like every 4 or 5 months, you hear about this, you know, thing that you hope is going away, and then you'll get this other crop of bad news that actually completely alters your life. We're in that process now, but now I've kind of come to terms with basically, okay, well, I'm going to go there for 2 weeks and answer all the questions truthfully, and I need a wardrobe stylist because I don't have 2 weeks worth of courtroom wear. That's for sure. I
mean, and they're going to. Let me answer this question, another technical minor question, but that's very important. I think, is it going to be videotaped?
Yes,
is it going to be live?
Yeah, I believe so.
So this will be on court TV.
I believe so. Yeah.
Oh my God.
I know.
Do you realize how great this is for Ratter?
Well, that's the thing. I mean, hopefully, if I don't make a fool of myself, sure. But I think that, you know, for the most part, I mean, my role in this case is basically just that I was like the author of this post, and I have to sit there and, you know, answer the questions, and I believe in the story, and the story was true. I mean,
what is the story? The videotape came out that they were having this affair or something. He denied he was doing it, and then the videotape came out?
It's not even that complex, unfortunately.
Okay.
I mean, it's ultimately that there was a source that had emailed me and said he was a fan of Deadspin. This was when I was at Gawker at the time. And said that a client of his has a package that he wants to send to me. I call him up. I ask him what it is. He tells me what it is. He's like, are you familiar with this? Because apparently there was, you know, TMZ and a couple other places already reported about the existence of this Hulk Hogan sex tape that was out there.
Yeah.
Hadn't followed it too much. And I'm like, no. And just like, send it along. Package comes to Gawker. I was away at the
physical
time.
Package.
Yes. With seating.
Okay, so this is a lawyer representing a client who has it, who wants to get paid?
No. He didn't want any money. It was actually a middleman, and it was actually just like a person that, you know, was working for a very popular radio DJ at the time.
Okay.
But it was a fan of a wrestling column on Deadspin and thought I was still working at Deadspin. But I got the tape, I watched it, and I said...
The full tape, the full hour-long
30
tape.
Minutes, 33 minutes or something along those lines.
Wow, Hulk's a hero. 30 minutes.
Well, it's not all...
Oh, okay.
You know, that's and that was the thing. I mean, we got this tape, and I was like, you know, well, I don't have a real desire to actually just, you know, profit or, like, you know, promote sex tapes in that way. Like, it wasn't a big honking exclusive for us. So I got the tape, I watched it, and I said, you know, we're going to show as much of, like, as little as possible in terms of just, like, we need to show that they're actually having sex and this happened.
Sure.
And then I'm going to do commentary about, you know, celebrity sex tapes and kind of do a recap of this. So the post was actually, as innocent as you can make a post about a sex tape, I mean, that was pretty much it.
And you were doing commentary on what was in the tape, which then... Yeah. Protects you because you can use any piece of media if you're doing commentary on it. If I took the photo of the year and I was a photojournalist doing, you know, I was a photo reviewer doing commentary, I'm allowed to use that even in a commercial setting. That's basic fair use.
Yeah. And that was what we were operating under those assumptions in terms of just like when we were like putting the post together. I mean, there was nothing.
So you did think about this, like what would be the fair way in terms of fair use? Because if it was somebody else's, if somebody owned it and intended to sell it, doing the whole thing would preclude their ability to then make money from it. Therefore, you used only a minute.
That was really just like what we were operating under. And I had no problem doing that because it wasn't really about the sex portion of the tape that I was actually interested in. I had to show that the sex existed, did that as little as possible, and mostly that was just to really lead into what was probably one of the best essays I've ever written, actually, in my life.
Really? What was your thesis in the post for people who didn't?
Well, it was more about how, you know, the celebrity sex tapes always seem kind of just like a lot more glamorous, and then like, and if you really take the time to look at them, they're actually not, and they're actually just like, you know, just they're just as sometimes, you know, ugly and awkward as like civilian sex at this
yes.
point. And you know, but Hulk Hogan's had all of this banter back and forth that was even made more bizarre because it's his best friend's wife, and just like,
oh,
you know,
really?
Yeah, yeah.
So he was saying all kinds of weird pillow talk.
Oh, there
or
was
sex talk.
A cell phone rang in the middle of him, you know, getting oral sex, and the ringtone was his daughter's song, and like, I mean, and he basically answers the phone in the middle.
The phone.
Oh yeah. Well, he looks at it. He looks at it and says, "No, I'm not getting it." It was that sort of, like, the banality of basically what was going on was actually more fascinating to me than an actual sex part.
So you write an interesting essay.
That was it, yeah.
You use a small portion of the tape.
Mm-hmm.
And he says he's suing you guys because it damaged him or it's his property or because it's Bubba the Love Sponge's property.
Right, but I believe they settled out of court already.
Yeah, they settled for something.
So now this is a $100 million in kind of emotional damages based off of invasion
What's
of privacy.
Privacy? I mean, you're journalists covering a. How does he win this? I mean, it's, if journalists get a piece of information, they write a critical essay about it. I mean, whether you believe you should have done it or not, it's fair game.
Yeah, and I believe I don't think we have it's because with this. You know, this case keeps getting every time it got thrown out of the federal court really quickly,
right?
Like in around December of 2020.
And what did they say?
Pretty much everything that I think anyone who's in media, like understands that this is like newsworthy. I mean, we actually just we're in the grounds of being newsworthy. Yeah, and
the newsworthiness being this is a huge celebrity, a huge radio.
And this was already reported on as like the methods that we did it. Albeit not the most traditional kind of straight ahead AP style, but at the same time, we were actually just, using everything that we had that we, thought we could do to present the story as truthful and accurate. And that's it. In Florida, there is a two-party consent for tapes. And so Hulk Hogan claiming that he was not consenting to this,
I mean,
opens it up to.
But that would be Bubba's deal. He's covertly recorded his
friend. Well, I mean, this is something that's, the judge who is handling this case, I mean, has basically just like, denied every motion to throw this out. So, I mean, this is where we are.
Wow.
And, that's going to be my summer vacation in Pinellas County, Florida.
It is pretty amazing that a case has gone this far because they also had the Scientology case. And I have to say, I really do respect Nick Denton. I mean, people think we have this crazy rivalry.
Yeah.
We had a small rivalry for a small period of time. And then we kind of had a unspoken, well, actually literally spoken, but unrevealed agreement after the Peter Rojas incidents.
Yeah.
That we could poke barbs at each other, but we were not going to damage each other's businesses anymore.
Yeah.
We could sort of, we had a little tete-a-tete, or whatever they call it, it's a little summit. Blog summit,
sense.
And we were just like, okay. He was like, okay, I did this, can we not do this anymore? Uh-huh. And we're like, yeah, okay, I won't poach any more people, and you won't say anything nasty about me. Great, okay, let's keep going. But boy, is he fearless. And I have to say, everybody was, I think, scared to death of the Church of Scientology because they have a practice of aggressively going after the personal lives of anybody. What do they call it? They have their own... term for fair game. Fair game is the term.
Right.
If you come at the Church of Scientology, L. Ron Hubbard believed they could come at you with full force.
And they dox you and like
they dox you, which means they put your documents out there publicly. They harass you. They follow you around. All this crazy.
They find out your most vulnerable moments and then basically just.
And they
like,
and they also try to make you stir crazy by putting you under surveillance.
Right.
So you guys did this. You took the hour-long.
Tom Cruise video,
Tom Cruise video.
And Nick was editor of Gawker at that time. Because you remember when he was editor-in-chief of Gawker?
Yeah, he's like, I'm going to come to the office every day. I was like, wow, that's going to last 2 weeks.
Really? Yeah, he blogged for a good 6 months.
He was good.
He was great. He was absolutely one of the best there ever was.
It's like Michael Jordan coming out of retirement. It's like, I'm going to show you kids
how it's done. Well, it was because, I mean, he just like, he knew exactly what he wanted most of the time. And basically just like, he kind of, didn't waver about, what he thought was newsworthy or what he thought was truth. And this was one of those things that, obviously, I mean, Scientology was very aggressively pushing back, and everyone was taking down the video. And he found a way, and it was also being yanked off of YouTube. So
yeah, you couldn't put it on YouTube because it was somebody else's property. They would claim they would sue. YouTube wouldn't stand up to them.
Right.
And Nick was like, "I'm just going to put it on my own file server and serve it myself."
Yeah. And
an hour-long video that must have been a huge bill.
I think it was.
And did they go after it? Because I watched it twice. I mean, it was fascinating.
Yeah, I mean, it still holds up today. I mean, especially after, the HBO documentary and everything like that. I mean, I think they
going
used that
clear.
Yeah. But
so did they try to go after Gawker? Did they try to go after Nick? Because Nick is pretty out there. He's like, I smoke weed, I'm gay.
I think that was the thing. Just like, Nick's and I've kind of adopted the same policy, basically. Just like, you can only like, you don't have to be as discreet as you normally would. And if you are, it's probably better for you in the long run.
Yeah.
Because you can see anything coming at
that
point. I don't remember any sort of problem with that other than the fact that I think most people seem to be like, oh, well, why didn't we think of that? Why? It's not that bad, actually. They got away with it. They're fine.
I think one of the things is, like, it takes somebody to say, well, I'm going to deal with this legal harassment and just rip up the letters and let them file their lawsuit and go full bat, go all the way to the mat on these issues. And what happens is the other side eventually caves.
Right.
Now, in the case of Hulk Hogan, they haven't.
Yeah.
But they will lose, I predict. And if they don't lose, I think they're going to lose on appeal.
Yeah.
Because I don't think, I think it will go to the Supreme Court if it has to, right?
Wouldn't that be bizarre? I mean,
I think it will have to. I mean, there's some issues that just cannot be decided by a local yokel court. No. Like the press's freedom to report on things, whether you agree with it or not.
Yeah, and I think that that's, you know, what hopefully just is the issue that the jury understands, that basically just like you, they shouldn't be in charge of actually just, you know, telling everyone else what's news and what's not.
Yeah.
And Hulk Hogan should not be able to do that as well.
Yeah, I mean, when Hulk Hogan becomes the editor-in-chief of the United States, it's kind of a sad state of affairs.
That's true. Yes, it is.
Pretty sad. Yeah. Okay, so let's talk about Ratter.com.
Okay.
You came to, I guess, me and a couple of other folks. You built up a collection of people you knew,
yeah.
I don't know, a year ago, and said, hey, I have an idea.
Uh-huh.
The idea is Ratter.com.
Right.
What was the idea you pitched a year ago? How has it gone?
Well, the initial pitch was actually kind of, you know, between Nick and I, we were having a conversation. It was just as Patch went under, and I just offhandedly said, you know, wouldn't it be great if Patch was more like Gawker? In some ways.
Patch being the local news site by AOL, which Tim Armstrong had funded privately. Then he bought it. Then AOL lost a reported $50 or $100 million on.
Right. But, I mean, they're doing a reclamation project, I believe, at this
point. They are?
Oh, yeah, I think so. Yeah, Warren St. John is editing. And Warren St. John was a very, you know, well-known New York Times editor for a while. And he's a good guy. So, I mean, you know, he's trying
Why
to...
Why did it fail? Go, why did Patch fail?
I mean, I think the same reason why Patch became, you know, almost like a more expensive local newspaper in a lot of ways. I mean, I think that just like, you know, they started to, you know, hire people and just think that the once you made it digital, that everyone would actually just like, you know, naturally kind of, you know, gravitate towards it. And it didn't happen that way. And I think that you had to understand that, and that was what I was going into Ratter thinking was that, you know, the internet is not local by any stretch of the imagination.
No, and it's the opposite of local. It's global.
Right. And you have to kind of treat the stories that way in order for it to work that way. And, you know, for Ratter to work that way, I remember when I'm conceptualizing this, I'm basically have, you know, Gawker in my DNA so much that I'm thinking of this as a site that's a Gawker San Francisco, Gawker LA, Gawker, that sort of thing. And, unknowingly too, and also just thinking about, like, you know, what it would look like, and I'm thinking just like, yeah, it would probably, you know, it could work well on Kinja, et cetera, et cetera.
Kinja being the publishing platform of the Gawker empire,
right? So, you know, you have that momentum, and I think the exhilaration of basically just, like, you know, getting your first round of funding through, and then just you have that, especially just like that seemingly interminable waiting period where it's just like kind of going from idea to actual, just like, you know, getting the first round, 7 months, basically just like kind of just waiting around, and then finally getting that, and then you want to get started, and because I'm on a CMS that's familiar in Kinja, and I'm basically have this concept in my head, I hire right away, basically just like thinking just like, yeah, this is blog in a box, basically, that I can build this up right away, and that's
and go like, after local issues.
Yeah, and also just like, you know, we were always going to be on Kinja for a short period of time, but also just like, you know, use it as kind of a testing ground for kind of to beta out some
what did you
stories.
Learn in the first whatever 7-8 months of doing this, like works locally
or what's here's the thing that ultimately just like was the most the thing that we learned the most was that, you know, I get Kinja a lot better right now. And I also see Kinja as almost like a microcosm of basically what everyone faces in the media at this point in terms of publishing. Because the only way Ratter was going to work was ultimately because it was a sub-blog on Kinja. If a sub-blog linked to Ratter, great. If a sub-blog that was part of one of the primary sites linked to Ratter, great. But you can't exist that way. But ultimately, Kinja is kind of like Facebook and what everyone else is facing in terms of just like that. You need that anchor to kind of really, or that audience distributor somewhere consistently in order to kind of build that up. So obviously it wasn't coming from Gawker because we're not a Gawker property. And, you know, what we saw when we were, you know, we have a new platform that we were going to in March, and now it's going to be done in July, that, well, if we're going to build a new site, we actually need to build an audience distributor first. Right. So we have to kind of build a router.com that actually people come to before we can actually have these local things potentially work. So it's really going back to what I think I do best, which is basically just like, you know, building audience off of just like stories that everyone will read.
Yeah.
And then, you know, using like saving our investment and kind of just like, you know, generating some of the ad network revenue and being real patient about it. Just doing straight freelancers and, you know, actually testing the stuff that I think will work better than anything else that's out there right now in terms of just like, you know, content.
So you're going slow, preserve the capital. You raise money from Nick Denton, mm-hmm. myself, and Mark Cuban.
Mm-hmm.
That's a pretty good trio to get, I think.
Yeah, yeah, and you know, four other investors.
Three or four others.
Yeah.
Anybody else notable in that group would know?
Joanne Wilson.
Oh, great.
Andrew Anker.
Oh, wow, great.
You know, Gabby Derbyshire.
So oh, yeah, sure. Is she still at Gawker or she left?
No, she left.
Yeah.
Just launch fund, I would say. You know, and but you know, all the people that you know are part of, you know, our investors have different levels of expertise and are basically just, you know, have different ways of success.
Sure.
And they've all been great so far,
yeah.
in terms of just okay, just, you know, trying not to make you. I think you go through this phase where you actually make things harder by overthinking them,
right.
sometimes. And trying to act like a company before you're actually a company. I mean, that's...
Yeah, some people become a company and they don't have a product yet. You're basically saying, let me just slowly figure out the product.
Yeah.
What works in local news.
Right.
Now, are you going to do... Is it going to be city-based primarily?
No,
you just
not.
Be like national, local news.
We're just going to do stories that basically just blow the doors off of everything else on the web. That's it.
Right.
That's where you have to start. You have to build an audience before you can basically just like, you know, start to kind of, you know, move away into these, you know, localized regions. And for the most part, I mean, we're carrying over 75 stories that were on, you know, that exist on Radar right now. Because, you know, the goal was to basically have these stories be able to stand alone and have a national audience,
right.
not just a local one.
So what is unique about sort of investigative journalism today and the web? It seems like people are not putting the time or the money into investigative journalism. How do you make that into a business? Because how much do you have to spend on an investigative piece to really make it pop nationally? Is it $1,000 or $5,000, $10,000?
You know, it depends.
And then how do you monetize it? I mean, that's the big thing. People are saying, oh, we're cutting our investigative journalism people. And the budgets for, you know, 60 Minutes or whatever it happens to be,
yeah.
New York Times. How do you intend on making that work? Do you have a strategy for that, or are you just going to figure it out?
Well, I don't think anybody has a real strategy for it because, I mean, it is very costly. I mean, reporting is costly. I mean, that's and I think lots of people are finding that out. It's but in order for it to have value, you also have to kind of just like, you know, take on that cost and offset it in some ways too.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's really the trick is basically just like, you know, I've always treated traffic as a business problem that needs to be solved.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's there are a lot of ways to do that. And, you know, there are a lot more ways of doing it than there were even 4 years ago. So once you establish that part, then I think you can basically just, you know, fund the types of journalism that you want on your site, but you have to kind of offset it with something else.
So having a bunch of traffic through this investigative journalist stuff, if you put up ad networks, you're going to make the money back, probably.
Yeah, yeah. And you know, ultimately, just like, you know, have, you know, the bulk of our investment just like, you know, kept intact for basically just like when we do want to make the next move, we do it basically just like, you know, with a real purpose. And like all the people that I hired, you know, editorially, I mean, they're all talented people. I would have hired them at every single site that I ever worked for before. But the reality is I have to build that site first in order for them to kind of justify them, you know, being part of something and like make it work for them. Because, I mean, right now, having people as part of just like a Kindle property that nobody reads, well, I mean, that's not going to benefit them nor us.
Yeah. So. What do you think about investigative journalism like video? I have always been a fan of this like hidden video stuff. Mm-hmm. And
I love it. I mean, I think there's the real market for Nightcrawler type. I think it's a real, I don't understand.
I love that movie Nightcrawler, by the way. If you haven't seen that movie,
I don't understand why people haven't kind of just like, you know, opportunistically just become those people at this point. I don't know why we don't see a lot of this cropping up, especially when we have, you know, stuff this live leak type footage. And I mean, with Periscope, with everything that's available right now, I mean, there is a market for that stuff out there.
I think if you guys just did investigative journalism via hidden camera, mm-hmm. which requires, I think, some really impressive legal understanding,
right.
which I don't have right now. Like, I never understood how do they when you do an investigative journalist piece and you send in the car that doesn't have the broken carburetor and you say the carburetor's making noise,
right,
and you put the cameras in the engine, the guy comes in and does nothing and just, you know, changes one, yeah, the plug's out, he puts the new plug, he just takes the plug, puts it in, and doesn't replace the carburetor, and then charges you $500.
Right.
And then they come and, like, how do they not get sued? And how is it legal? And what's,
I mean,
legal?
I don't know. I mean, like, yeah, you know, local news broadcasts have been doing that, like, kind of just like the I team for years.
I love, I mean, the I team. The I team's going away, though.
It actually has. You know, yeah, I mean, I think that right now, I mean, it just seems like that, you know, more people are, especially just like, you know, in light of everything that's going on in terms of just, you know, between, you know, post Ferguson right now. I mean, people are just like, you know, a lot more able to kind of just like tell a better story than, you know, they were able to before. And I mean, I just think that that's naturally going to start to gravitate towards basically just like, you know, crime stories and kind of uncovering some things that basically just like, you know, have people weren't able to get access to before. So I mean, I think there's a real market for that.
I love the inconvenient truth kind of stuff too. I don't know, mm-hmm, if you remember, what's his name? Michael Moore, yeah, had a show called The Horrible Truth. Was something like that. He basically had his own reality, right, like show for, I don't know, a couple of years. Emmy award-winning producer, Jack, you can look it up. But Michael Moore's TV show. And he did this thing like being black in New York and getting a cab.
Mm-hmm.
And he literally put a black man on the street in New York,
right,
and would try to get a cab. And he would put, you know, the next block, a white woman.
Right.
10 out of 10 cabs, skip.
Yeah.
The black man. Okay, The Awful Truth was the name of it. Thank you, Jackie. And then they put a guy in a chicken suit.
Right.
The chicken suit guy gets picked up for the black guy. Then they put, you know, the next thing, the most ridiculous. Then they put a white guy with a bat. Then they put a white guy with a chainsaw. Then they put a white guy with a machete, mm-hmm, or a sword. Like, they're just like, the cab drivers will pick up anybody but a black guy. They'll, right, literally pick up a, you know, a white guy with a battle axe with blood on it before they would pick up a black guy. And it was just like, wow, that is some crazy social commentary. But with the Ferguson stuff, it's deadly serious. I mean, if you did a investigative piece of, like, these police departments, holy cow, would that be important, yeah, work? I would love to see somebody just drive, and I mean, God, whoever would do this would be a hero and also risking their lives. But if you drove through those places that are known to have racist cops or, mm, questionable cops or, you know, questionable incidents that have occurred and videotaped it?
Right.
That would be incredible.
Well, I mean, I think that's actually, you know, happening. I mean, I do think that, you know, one of the things that I think just is, if Twitter fails, like, for any reason, I mean, you're going to lose one of the best media outlets there is right now. I mean, it's, yeah, completely changed breaking news.
How so?
Because you can't tell me that Twitter hasn't been broken better stories than mainstream media in like the last 5 years. I mean, Twitter owned Ferguson. Twitter owned,
absolutely,
so many things, and there's, it's actually, you know, revealed a lot of people to be, you know, great journalists, and basically just like, you know, there is a skill set between people who are able to kind of just like use Twitter properly, and more often than not, they don't necessarily have to be kind of traditional journalists. But I mean, just like, you know, the way that, you know, the coverage has happened, basically just like, you know, from Ferguson to Baltimore to just, you know, anything that is breaking, I mean, Twitter's done the best job at it. And I think that, you know, without it, I don't see any of the traditional media outlets actually doing anything better than Twitter's ever done in that capacity.
What do you think of this subscription revenue type stuff where, or funded journalism? Mm-hmm. It's come up over and over again. Can we get journalism funded? Can we get, you know, people to pay a little bit? Today, sadly, Circa, which is a mobile news app,
right,
which a lot of people think Inside is competitive with. In fact, it's completely different services.
Right.
They're both mobile news, but they were actually writing long stories and had journalists. We were just,
yeah,
doing curation, two different things. And, you know, I'm an investor actually in Circa, small investor,
right,
so I apparently lost money today. But that didn't work. They didn't even try to monetize,
mm-hmm,
according to their blog post. They just were just trying to do great stuff. But I think there's such an amazing opportunity to have people fund you just in small Patreon, recurrency,
yeah,
whatever, like things. I mean, if you said, I am going to do Ferguson journalism and I just need to get 1,000 people or 500 people to give me $10 a month to fund it.
Yeah.
That's got to work.
I think so. I mean, because and I was thinking of it in the ways of just like, I mean, I think that, you know, newspapers, especially, just like, I think should help Twitter do their job better. I mean, that's, you don't need to send people down to Because I mean, I think DeRay McKesson just like, you know, absolutely just like, you know, ran circles around everybody when it comes to basically.
DeRay was the on the ground journalist.
Yeah, and I mean,
is he a real journalist or is he just like
no,
a dude?
No, but I mean, he was just
a dude who said, "I'm going to document everything."
He basically just like, you know, put the actual story out there in a way that I think most people just like, you know, just were overlooking. And I think that's really what the job of mainstream media is most of the time too.
Right.
And I think it just like, you know, if there was a newspaper that just like went out there and said, you know, okay, you know, we're going to let this guy tell the story as opposed to basically just like sending in a reporter there. I mean, pay him
right
to tell the story. I mean, why do you need a wire service when basically just like this guy is basically telling the story better than anybody right now?
Right. But he's not trained. He's not a member of the staff. He doesn't have he didn't go to Columbia.
I mean, if we're having that argument still in this day and age, I mean, then you're
right. That's probably what the New York Times is thinking.
Of course,
like, this is not the guy.
But they'd rather profile him than actually just like, you know, let him do the work.
Right.
I mean, let him do the work. That's the
right
thing. Like, I mean,
give him an editor.
Yeah, I mean, but I mean, if you can do, he's basically just like already working. So mm-hmm. now you basically just like, you know, cede all coverage to him, basically. Instead,
right.
Especially if you're, you know, using wire services or basically sending reporters down there aren't going to do as great a job as him. Just
right.
And there are plenty of people on Twitter I think can get that type of funding and basically just like also just like, you know, help out.
But they're not doing it. They're not getting funded. I guess they're not trying.
No, but I'm saying just like, why don't the newspapers actually fund them?
It would be interesting to say like, well, just we're going to make you a stringer.
Give a stringer, but I mean, also just like, I mean, couldn't you do something along the lines of basically just, you know, have a ad deal, which essentially just like goes along with that coverage?
Yeah.
I mean, if you take
that would be very
like
interesting.
Local news TV coverage. Like you say that you just put that on Twitter. You pick like, you know, all your, that, because there's really deserves some, outside of the weather, what do people look at local news on television for at this point?
A viral YouTube video that's
exactly
going to be teased 18 times by the, I mean, I'm watching local news is like going to the trending
right.
page at YouTube where it's like, or Reddit, here's the video you won't believe that we did not clear rights for.
Yeah, so you already have
the end of the show.
You already have the platform in place, which is basically just like, you know, Twitter's kind of just like, you know, doing the job supporting kind of local television news. And we'll actually, you know, break the news before the local TV station does. So I mean, why don't you actually just, you know, put all the money into making Twitter.
This is why I think Twitter should have a revenue model where they split revenue with the most important accounts.
Mm-hmm.
So what I think they should do is if you get verified, and you should be able to pay to get verified, where like they literally get you to put your driver's license in,
right.
you know, verify, do not a background check as such, but, you know, we know that you are an individual who you say you are, or at least at the time you did this
right.
account, you are AJ, you are Jason, we sent mail to your house, we got your credit card, we got your passport, whatever it is. We verified. Now, if they said any time in your tweets, in between your tweets, we're going to put ads and give you 70% of the revenue for those ads or for your videos, which they're already splitting revenue from what I understand with the top, you know, NBAs of the world, then that person could just go to work.
Yeah.
And like all of a sudden they're trending. And the more traffic they get, the more revenue comes in.
It seems to make sense.
Killer.
Yeah.
Make me the CEO of Twitter. I'll do it in 2 minutes. I'll fix the whole thing.
Uh-huh.
No, I won't fix the whole thing. So you spent 7-8 months. You're rebooting now. New site comes in July.
Yeah. I mean, I'm going to let the Hogan trial pass just because, I mean, I don't know how.
Oh, wait. But you have to have a website up. And you have to do a lot of interviews and say, put your email in for the new router. Put a landing page up and collect 10,000 emails. How many emails do we have? Zero? We don't have a mailing list?
Yeah.
Get a mailing list going. And be like, router's going to continue to do investigative journalism. Put your email in. Get to 20,000 emails.
Yeah. It is tricky because of just like, you know, my participation in this and everything that I do is actually just like, you know, can be held accountable basically just like through this trial at this point.
Yeah.
So
I don't think though, if you're on trial and you agree to do interviews, if they say you're with router.com and router.com has an email sign up form, I don't think that's unreasonable.
You'd be surprised.
Are you going to hold it against you? Who knows?
So far.
You seem a little nervous about it, but not completely broken.
Well,
about it.
Because
what's the worst case scenario? You get sued,
I mean,
and you have a lien against you.
I think this is the worst.
You have to file for bankruptcy.
Yeah, pretty much. But I mean, look. I mean, that's the thing that
are they going to get your trust fund?
Just
is your
like,
trust fund protected, AJ? The huge trust fund your parents left you.
You know, well, no. I mean, it was interesting. You know, when I was going through the punitive damages discovery process, I'm like, you know, what's it going to take? My house plants? I mean, at this point, I mean, like, you know, there's not
a $10 million loft on the Central Park West. They're going to get
no. but I mean, I think just I have utmost confidence in the story that, I mean, there was nothing that, there were a lot of things that basically just like, you know, could have been considered a lot more questionable than this story. Put it that way.
Of course.
And this is one that I absolutely am proud of, and one that actually just like, you know, did its job on every single level, which was basically just like, you know, and the fact that it's still being talked about in 2.5 years, well, I think I did a great job then.
Yeah, for sure. And you know what? It is a, these, I mean, there are publications out there that take a tip line, make it into a story, and never even contact the subject.
Right.
So there are plenty of people who would just run with a tip from their tip line without ever calling the subject. And they're like, well, we publish it, then we find out if it's true. This process journalism, which is kind of BS, right?
Yeah. And I've engaged in that before, but I mean, at the same time, I think that you have to know exactly which rocks to look under. And most people that work at Gawker, I think, you know, the better site leads actually just like, you know how to use that tip line very well, and basically just like know when there's something you have to kind of just like, you know, go back to and say that just like, all right, this could potentially be something that's absolutely unique and interesting. So, I mean, let's double down on this.
And actually do journalism and random acts of journalism and research.
I mean, whatever it is. But I mean, you know, for Hogan, I mean, this thing, you know, it exploded only after he filed a lawsuit. So, I mean, this was like an interesting scenario where it's just like, it wasn't like a blockbuster runaway hit when we first dropped it. And then, after, over time, it's become one of these things that's obviously, you know, could potentially just like, you know, bury Gawker, so.
What's the percent? I mean, you'd believe Nick when he says there's a 10% chance of Barry's Gawker. Because doesn't he have all those things separated out into all kinds of different licensing things in Croatia, wherever the hell he's got all this stuff hidden in the IP?
I think it just, like I said, I mean, just because it's been, you know, the judge's decision-making process has been always been unfavorable for the most part, that I think he's, you know, playing the worst-case scenario here, which is probably just like, you know, good odds considering, like I said, every step of the way it's been worst case scenario.
Right.
So, you know, who knows? But I don't think any of that's really going to hinge on either of our testimonies.
Yeah.
But, you know, we're both going to be there.
It's a jury trial.
Yeah. In Pinellas County, Florida, which I mean, is not. Not many of them are Gawker readers, I don't think.
Florida makes me nervous. All the places in the South make me nervous, but Florida's like weird, man.
Yeah.
Anything can happen in Florida.
But I mean, it's just,
I never invest in businesses
from Florida.
You know,
you're going to have kind of just like the showcase of creeps, basically just like in this courtroom between Hulk, Nick, and myself, basically just like all, and it's
just nobody likable.
No, not at all.
Just like, here's the writer who wrote up this, you're going to read your thing out loud and be like, here is some punk from New York who wrote a thing about
I was gonna come with an Iron Sheik T-shirt on, I don't plan
here's
on.
Here's the gay Jewish guy from New York, publisher.
Here's the guy
who is having sex with his friend's wife and taking a phone call in the middle of it.
And
so, I mean, nobody's likable.
Yeah, and there's not really any way you can actually out-spectacle the natural spectacle that's already happening with this.
Oh my God, I had a brilliant idea for you.
My deposition, I mean, was. When I had that done about a year and a half ago, the guy that was videotaping the deposition just like, you know, started cracking up in the middle. Because, I mean, just the stuff is that's the, being, you know, done
is
the by video, these stuffy lawyers.
The depositions will be public, right?
Yeah.
Those videos? Yeah. Do you have your video?
I don't have it, but it will be.
Oh, you got to get a copy of that from your lawyer and own that. That's going to be in the public domain.
Yeah, it will be. And, you know, I have my other deposition. And I mean, it's just. And, of course, it was just like a year and a half ago. And I think that there's stuff that's basically just like I was a lot more defiant than I think I should have been at that
point. Oh, you were a little more defiant? Well, they tell you I've been through a deposition. When you do this, they tell you don't answer unless it's a question and say as few words as possible. So you're supposed to just sit there. And they're like, so you got the Hulk Hogan tape.
Yeah.
And you're supposed to go like this.
After 8 hours and a guy poking at you, you know, sometimes you fly
off. Then your counsel's like, he doesn't have to answer that. Don't answer that. And he's like, well, he does have to answer.
And then we, you know, I think Nick and I both suffered through the same things. We're basically just, we kind of just like overruled our own objections basically from our own lawyers and basically answered questions that we
You're like, I'll answer it. I don't care.
Yeah, exactly.
Did you do a Justin Bieber where he's like, don't mention her? Remember that when Justin Bieber was
I didn't
tell me about Selena Gomez. He's like, Selena Gomez. He's like, don't mention her name again.
I, I, if anything, I put out way too much information, but like personal about myself. That was basically just like, you know, volunteered like on my own. I mean, that was my one fault in that deposition.
All right, what's about the, so anyway, I had an idea for you. Why don't you write up, this would be a great Ratter thing to do. Mm. You say, I'm going to write up my thoughts every day at the trial in an email summary. Just my thoughts on the trial.
Right.
And just collect a bunch of emails, and it's just your trial log.
Yeah.
Just do the trial log. I was actually
going to do that.
I think it's very important that you document this.
Yeah.
As a way for yourself to process it, and also for the historical purposes. Like it's not an important story in the grand scheme of things, but it's an important case in the grand scheme of things, because this stuff never goes to the mat.
Absolutely. Yeah. No, I think it's a great idea, and I think that's something that we're actually, you know, discussing doing, and I think we will actually do that.
Well, I'm going to end with this. What is the story with the unionization of the Gawker writers? Is this just to get press? And is it the story with the unionizing of the writers?
Again, I mean, I don't work there anymore. And I mean,
but I saw that guy Joel Johnson wrote a whole big thing where he, like, I guess he no longer works there.
He
exposed everything about the company in a long blog post. It's like Kinja loses $10 million in its history. This makes this. This did that. I mean, what a bunch of sour grapes. And he's got to have a non-disclosure as management.
Well, but then the non-disclosure actually just like flies in the face of them. What's Kinja good for if we can't break non-disclosure agreements on Kinja? You know, so. But I mean, I don't know. But I think that whatever gives the writers their peace of mind is good for them.
It's hilarious, though, that like if we were sitting here 10 years ago, we're like, number one, Gawker still exists.
Yeah.
Or Engadget still exists. We would have been like, probably not.
Yeah.
These things are just like little interesting experiments, right. But that there's 100 people working at Gawker and you know, media, and they're 80% of them or 70% of them voted to unionize.
Right. The thing is, it's like, I don't know why, because we don't work in an industry that, I mean, I think it just actually caters to people staying at one place for a long period of time.
No.
So, and I like that fact about their industry that, I mean, we're able to kind of evolve and basically just you know, leave places and go to try other things and sometimes fail at other places. So, for me, I wouldn't understand basically just like the sense of safety that people would get from unionizing at Gawker outside of basically 2 years.
Mm. You know. What's the story with the Brett Favre story? There was a lot of pics and voicemails. What was that about back in the day?
Oh, well, I mean, that was a story that, you know, we broke on Deadspin that took around 9 months. Whereas there was a woman named Jen Sturger who was actually, you know, contacting me for a completely different story. And I had asked her if she had ever received any, dick pics from basically professional athletes, and she told me that, yeah, it happens all the time, and you wouldn't believe the one guy who actually, you know, did it to me, and it happened to be Brett Favre. The way I got to that story was basically just publishing that whole entire conversation I had with her without her permission in order to kind of just shake the trees a little bit, because I figured somebody else had to have these voicemails and pictures, which they did, and I paid $10,000 for them, and you know, ran them on the site.
Now, let me talk to you about that. Mm-hmm. What's the story with paying for stuff? This is a practice you think is a good idea?
I think if it completes the story, if there is a piece of information that is out there that it will actually just like, you know, kind of tie the story in a bow and basically just like, you know, put it all together for you, yes.
How do you know that people are not then entrapping people to get it on video? In other words, I'm a guy trying to seduce a woman, mm-hmm. or a woman trying to seduce a guy, or a guy and a guy, whatever it is. And I meet them, I flirt with them, I get them to send me a private selfie shot in order to sell it.
Well, but that's...
Or does it matter?
I paid for around 3 or 4 things at Gawker, and they were really just beyond little petty stuff, like the Josh Hamilton photos. I mean, these were stories that required this level of kind of just
confirmation. Yeah,
absolutely, in order for them to actually just work.
So you have to make an editorial judgment.
Yeah,
you're not just going to like be out there and like, hey, I'm going to buy 10 sets of photos from the same person who's sprayed it and trapping people.
And we had a little fun with it when we were at Deadspin, in terms of just like we used to kind of just like, you know, put out stuff, because after the Brett Favre thing kind of just like went huge, there were a lot of people trying to sell us stuff and me personally, and we would actually just like, you know, put this stuff on the auction block and basically just like put a price tag on it. We would have like, you know, people kind of appraise basically what
LeBron James's penis is worth this much.
It would always, they would always be very arbitrary numbers like $37.73 for like.
So you're just goofing on yourself.
Yeah, because I mean, ultimately, it was also a good way to vet everyone too, like that we were coming them. So it was kind of being transparent about the stuff that we were offered. And just,
what
like,
didn't
showing,
you run?
I mean, we ran.
Tell me the things you didn't run that you were like, whoa, we thought we were going to run it, but we couldn't run it, or we didn't run it for whatever reason. What comes to mind that you were like, this was would have been incredible, blow the doors off stuff?
Well, I don't think there was anything that was actually going to blow the doors off stuff. But I mean, there were a lot of just like, you know, mid-level athletes that were caught in compromising positions, whereas basically, you know, after Brett Favre story happened, seemed like it was almost like you were desperate for trying to kind of just like recreate that someplace else. And like it was no longer a shock to kind of just like have a mistress send you basically just like, you know, pictures from just like, you know, mid-level NBA star. Like that, she
and you're like, I don't really need to put the sixth man on the Atlanta Hawks on trial.
I mean, unless there was something a bigger story around it that was basically just like a lot more unique. But I mean, there you got a lot of those things, and you know, some of that stuff after a while, I mean, like you said, I mean, would probably do great numbers for another site at that point. But at the same time, just like, you know, what I said to the staff at Deadspin after the Brett Favre story broke was basically just like, you know, we have to embrace the story, but we can't chase it ever again. Like, and you know, this was a good moment for the site that
you don't want to be known for that though. Like, we're the guys who
get people
in compromising positions every day.
And then, you know, Monty Teo came along and basically just like, you know, shifted the whole entire conversation. So I mean, that's
why did he shift the conversation? Because he was catfished.
Yeah, and I mean, that became just like, you know, Deadspin's, you know, biggest story. And
that was a bizarre story. The guy had a girlfriend.
Yeah, who everyone was talking about. Like, I mean, most of the mainstream media, like, you know, Sports Illustrated did a profile about just like, you know, Monte Teo and basically just like, you know, how he's dealing with his, you know, dying girlfriend who eventually died, and basically just like the student outreach and like pouring about, you know.
But
he
never met her.
No.
It was a virtual girlfriend.
She was a fictional character.
That was created by some bizarre person who was trolling him.
Yes.
Oh, that is... What is the psychology of a person who falls for catfishing, and what is the psychology of a person who catfishes another person? Catfishing being defined as catching somebody with a fake girlfriend.
Even more,
or seducing somebody with a fake girlfriend, boyfriend.
When Tommy broke that story, and just like, it was Tim Burke and Jack Dickey and like a bunch of the people that were at Deadspin, when they broke that story, I think the biggest thing they revealed was ultimately just the level of fact-checking that was basically just, like, not done by every single mainstream media outlet, which is pretty obvious stuff, kind of looking about, okay, you're talking about this girlfriend.
Yep.
Nobody actually checked if she went to the school she went to. Nobody ever checked for a death certificate.
Like, so basically, fact-checking is a dead art was the
I mean, they really, it was too good a story for them to, like, not, like, actually just, like, you know, let, like, it was too good a story for it to basically possibly be not true.
do you think that drives journalism today in that, if this story is so salacious and I will get page views, I don't want to kill my own story by checking the facts. Is that a phenomenon?
I think when it's a feel-good story, yes.
Ah.
I don't think it's a negative one. I think people
Stone story about the rape by the fraternity or the alleged rape by the fraternity, the journalist did no fact-checking.
Well, I mean, you go into a completely different gray area, basically, just of what has to happen, especially just like with stories of that, you know, type of.
That's an area where you should be super buttoned up, no?
Well, I think that, you know, more than anything else is basically just like you have to kind of just really understand basically just like, you know, the power of that story that you're writing and how it can impact everyone else's life.
The collateral damage is huge.
Yeah. But I mean, also just, you know, look, the writer trusted her source, and that's pretty much just like I would have absolutely called, just like, you know, done the same thing. So I mean, just like, you know, how do you argue basically just like against not doing that? And I understand exactly what the fact checking process is, but the bottom line is, I mean, just like, you know, here's a woman telling you a story, and you have no reason to not believe her.
But you have to check the other side. I mean,
I think the other side was checked. I mean, it just, but I, at the
didn't
same
feel token, like it was checked.
Yeah, but I mean, look, I mean, it, you know, that story, and just, I think along the lines, basically, just like you look at And I'm talking more about like kind of just like, you know, those BuzzFeed stories that'll just like have, you know, here are 24 photos that'll restore your faith in humanity that are kind of just like, you know.
Entertainment.
Yeah. But I mean, just the, like stories of that nature, which are very valuable to people and people want them to be true. If you actually went back and kind of just like, you know, debunked a lot of those pictures that they're using, about, like, you're going to be disappointed. I mean, I think, you know, when.
Of the 24 things that'll make you feel great today.
Well, I mean, you know, Gawker had that. Gawker had that kind of just like incident where basically, you know, Nissan ran a Nissan Zimmer, and it was like, you know, what the viral editor at Gawker at the time, you know, ran the story that was going blowing up on Facebook because they, you know, someone had saved a kitten from a tree, but the kitten died 2 hours later.
It was like, yeah, let's not tell that piece.
Exactly. Yeah.
So yeah. I resuscitated the kitten. Mm-hmm. It was the resuscitation story. The fireman like resuscitated the kitten.
Yeah.
Who then died?
Yeah. So I mean, you don't want to. Got to bury that lead. You
know? You'll never believe how this kitten died.
Right.
8-part slideshow. Okay, well, listen, we're all looking forward to the trial, and that's going to be super entertaining for us and terrifying for you.
No, we're
looking forward to your trial log at Ratter.com. Continued success with Ratter, and good luck on the reboot.
Thanks.
And the relaunch, Ratter Official on Twitter, Ratter.com, AJ Daulerio, Daulerio on the Twitter. Hey, listen, I think this might be the last show where Jacob is actually the director, and so I'm going to miss you, Jacob. Great job. You really leveled up the show in your year and a half here. And congratulations to Emmy Award-winning producer Jackie on her one-year anniversary. You both were a dynamic duo, leveled up the show. And, of course, I get a lot of credit for the show, which is totally fine by me. But the truth is, to do a show like this, there's many more people involved in it than just me. And in fact, the bulk of the work occurs behind the cameras in finding the great guests, editing the show. And for that, I thank Jackie and Jacob. And Jacob, continued success in your career. You were one of the hardest working, most dedicated people I've ever worked with. And I thank you personally for making me look good every week here on This Week in Startups. And I'm going to miss you, buddy. All right. We'll see everybody next time. Thanks to WeWork for hosting us. And thanks to our sponsors. Bye-bye.